Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Shiloh Neighborhood Church. To everyone who calls this your church home, welcome back. And to anyone who's new, special welcome to you. My name's Josh. Glad you're here. This is the second week in the season of Advent, and we have lit our second Advent candle. Advent is the season where we are looking forward to Christmas, not just because it's a fun holiday, but because we're remembering what it was like for the people in the Old Testament to wait for the Messiah to come. And we recognize that Jesus is the Messiah. He's the promised King who makes all things new. But we also know that our world is a mess, and we still are waiting for God to restore all things. We believe that Jesus is coming again, and so we're waiting for that day when King Jesus rules the world with perfect justice and righteousness and brings us peace. In Advent, we celebrate four themes: hope, peace, joy, and love. And so today is the second Sunday. We're looking at the idea of peace. So every week we begin the service by taking a deep breath and remembering that God is present with us. And as we do that today, let's remember that it is the God of peace who is with us. So I invite you to get in a comfortable position and take in a deep breath. God of peace, you are with us. And breathe out. And breathe in slowly again. God of peace, we're thankful for your presence. And breathe out. So those of you who are new, what we do is during the week, I put up our sermon on Wednesday nights, and so you can watch it at any point. You could watch it before the service or after the service. And then on Sundays, we briefly recap what the sermon is about, and then we reflect on scripture in other ways. We sing, we share in communion. So later we'll be sharing communion. If you have bread and crackers, bread or crackers and wine or grape juice, you can have those for later. But this week in our sermon, we looked at the story of Rahab. During this Advent, we're looking at the four women who are listed as Jesus's maternal ancestors in Matthew 1, right before the Christmas story. And this week we looked at Rahab. She was a woman who lived in the city of Jericho, which God's people, Israel, were about to come and take over. Rahab was a prostitute. And as we've seen in the last couple stories we've looked at, prostitutes aren't people who are choosing to live a life because they want to. They're women who are put into a situation where things are really desperate, and they're trying to survive, they're trying to provide for themselves and for their families. And we see Rahab caring for her parents and her brother and sister. So it appears that she's in a situation where things are really desperate. But Rahab has heard that there's a new God on the way to Jericho, bringing his people. She's heard of this God Yahweh, who's bringing his people. And in the ancient world, they believed that gods and goddesses would defeat other gods and goddesses because through the war of their people. So she's heard this God Yahweh who's coming. And because Yahweh has defeated other countries, other gods and goddesses, he must be really powerful. And so she knows that her life in Jericho is really bad if she's put into this situation. And she's afraid of the people of Israel who are coming. But she also chooses to throw in her lot with the God Yahweh, the God who we read about in the Bible. All the people are terrified, including Rahab, but she chooses to help Yahweh's people, which is an ancient way of giving her allegiance to Yahweh, to the God of Israel, instead of the gods and goddesses that she and her family and friends were worshiping in Jericho. Like Rahab, we've heard that Jesus is on the way. We've heard of some great things he's done, how he has set people free. And it's, to be honest, a little bit scary to give our allegiance to Jesus instead of pursuing the things that we have pursued through our whole lives. In Advent, we remember that Jesus came once. He's done some things, but we also know that he's coming again, and so we're waiting for that to happen. We, like Rahab, have to make the choice to renounce the things in this world that compete for our loyalty, the things that we too often choose to pursue instead of pursuing Jesus. In Advent, we recognize that we can't find peace in the other things we pursue. We can only find peace in Jesus, the God who's coming. Jesus is on the way. And as we remember that during this season of the year, it enables us to, all year, continue to live in a way that looks different, to set aside the things we normally pursue and pursue Jesus. So that means we don't deny that things are messed up in the world. We pay attention to that fact, and we cry out to God to come and save us, to be with us, to be Emmanuel, God with us, and to bring us his peace. So we're going to sing a couple songs this morning that reflect on that, and I invite you to sing along to help shape your heart and your mind to be like Jesus, to recognize that we need him, we need his help. Let's sing together.
Some captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou root of Jesse free, thine own from Satan's tyranny. From depths of hell thy people raise, and give them o'er the grave. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to of all mankind. Bid thou our sad division cease, and be thyself our King of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to let the
Let's pray our generosity prayer together. Godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world, and we take nothing out of it. We who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. We are determined to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on God and not the uncertainty of wealth. We desire to be rich in good deeds and willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. Amen. Practicing generosity is how we become the people of Advent, the people who aren't waiting for the next big move in the stock market or the next stimulus package that our government has. We're waiting for God to make all things new, and that's the economy we're invested in. We've begun praying this prayer every week throughout this year, because the truth is, many of us check our finances a lot more than once a week. We might check on our savings account, retirement, just when you get paid. You're thinking of your finances often. When you pay bills, you're thinking of your finances often. And so we recite this prayer weekly to remind us as often, or at least close to as often, that we need to remember that our hope is in the age to come, the thing we're waiting for in Advent, not in our financial situation. So we practice generosity. We don't just say these things, we do this through giving to people all around us. One of the ways we can be generous is by giving to our church, and I'm thankful for all of you who are so generous and consistent and faithful in giving to our church. If you'd like to give to our church, you can go on shilohnc.com/give, and you can give online, or you can find our church address there if you'd like to mail a check. Also, if you have a financial need or you know someone with a financial need, you can email us and let us know about that need, and our benevolence team can meet and figure out how to help you, as we've set aside a portion of everything that's given to take care of our church family and the people we know. One other announcement I want to share is that next Sunday we'll be having an in-person outdoor service. So you're invited to join us at 10:30 in the church parking lot. You can stay in your car or you can sit outside on a chair. And if you prefer, you can join us online. We'll live stream on YouTube. And I hope things will work better than last time where we had some technical difficulties. I think we've sorted that out. So let's begin reflecting on the passage we'll be looking at today. Today we're going to reflect on Isaiah 9, which is a famous passage that you hear a lot around Christmas time, around Advent. We'll be reflecting on this passage, we'll be reading it, and then going through it one or two verses at a time and allowing God to speak to us. So let's read it one time just to become familiar with it. And you can listen. If you'd like to get out a Bible and follow along, you're welcome to do that as well. Isaiah 9. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations, by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness. From that time on and forever, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. As we go through this passage, we'll be reflecting on one or two verses at a time. So let's ask God to speak to us, to guide our thoughts, and to help us know him as we do that. Holy Spirit, we acknowledge that you're with us in each place where we're participating in this service, and we ask you to direct us, to counsel us, to guide us. Help us to see what it is you want to say to us today. Lord, we thank you that we can learn through sermons during the week, but we also are thankful that we can meet with you, meditate on scripture, and hear your voice directly to us. So we pray that we would hear you and not just our own thoughts. and that you would change us in the areas we need to be changed, and that you would encourage us in the places we need to be encouraged. In Jesus' name, amen. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. The passage begins in darkness. And Advent is the beginning of the Christian year. In the historic calendar year of the church, Advent is the first season. And Advent is a season of darkness waiting for light to come. Advent begins with darkness. The year begins with darkness. Christianity is not meant to be a religion of denying that things are bad in the world and pretending like everything is happy and good. We are meant to be honest with the fact that things aren't as great as they could be. They're not as great as they should be. Things are dark. In the message this week, we looked at the story of Rahab, a woman living in the city of Jericho with an army coming, and it says that she and everyone else there were afraid. Isaiah is writing to the people living in Jerusalem hundreds of years later, and they weren't living in a powerful country at all. They were hillbillies living up in the hills in these small towns, and they're surrounded by powerful nations like Egypt and Assyria and Babylon, the global superpowers of their day. And these nations would go back and forth past Israel and through it to fight each other, and they would trample the land, and the people of Israel were living with the constant threat of war, especially in the time of Isaiah. Anxiety, fear, poverty, and uncertainty were the normal way of life. Maybe you're in that place where anxiety, fear, poverty, or uncertainty are a normal part of your life. Maybe you're not. I'd like to invite you to reflect on how it would feel to be a person living in a time and place like that. And if that is how you're feeling, you can reflect on how you're feeling, or you can reflect on how the people living at the time would have felt. What's a position that you put your body in when you're feeling tense? Do you clench your teeth or raise your shoulders, maybe? Pay attention to your body and see if there is any discomfort as you think about what it feels like to live in darkness. Let's reflect on maybe how we're feeling or how the people living in these times in the Bible would have felt, and then pay attention to how your body is processing that. This verse acknowledges darkness, but it promises light. So I'd like to invite you to relax, to think of that part of your body that's tense and allow it to relax, take in a deep breath, and listen to these words. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. This land that's on the verge of war is suddenly rescued. These people suddenly experience relief. And there are a number of examples of what that relief feels like. And so as I read these examples, I'd like to invite you to imagine the kind of relief that a person in that situation would feel. It says, you have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. You have enlarged the ethnicity and increased their joy. Things are going well for them. Imagine if you were in a place where war was around you and suddenly there was peace and prosperity. Imagine how relieved you would feel. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest. Imagine if you were a farmer and you've planted your crops and you're worried that something might go wrong, a disease or the wrong weather conditions or a fire, and you're worried about your crops spoiling. Suddenly, you've finished your harvest. Everything is good. It was a good year's crop, and now you can rest a little bit. Imagine how relieved you would feel. They rejoice before you as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. Imagine if you were a soldier and you went into battle and it was tense and scary, but you win and now you can rest and enjoy your victory. Imagine how relieved, how joyful you would feel. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Imagine if you were living in a country and there was a more powerful country that had occupied the land and been very cruel and unjust, but suddenly that occupying country was gone. Suddenly the people are free. Suddenly you're free. Imagine how relieved and joyful you would feel. It can be kind of hard to imagine these situations because a lot of them aren't our experience. So imagine how things will feel when the pandemic is over, when you'll be able to see friends and family, and you won't have to wear a mask or stay apart, and you won't have to be afraid that if you take off your mask or get too close that you might get them sick or they might get you sick, and it will just be fine to be together. Imagine how it will feel to be able to give people hugs, to sit next to each other, to talk, to be together. Imagine how relieved and joyful you'll feel. That feeling is what it's like when light comes into the darkness. Now, the situation the people were in was of military oppression. There was another country that was right around them who was threatening them. And so we might be tempted to imagine that their relief and joy will come from their own military victory, of a revolution, of defeating their enemies. But the next few verses tell us that God's plan is actually to end war altogether. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. We often, when we're desperate for relief, we pursue winning at any cost. And that doesn't actually bring us true peace. It can bring us a sense of relief for the time being, but it isn't a sustainable peace that brings everyone into that place of relief, both ourselves and our enemies. And God wants to restore everyone. God wants to bring everyone into a place of peace. Sometimes we think that if we win, we will find the relief we need. We will find the peace we need. But living that way only brings peace to us, not to others. It's not what's best for others. And the truth is that's not real peace, so it's actually not what's best for ourselves either. So we need to think about, how can I love my neighbor as I love myself? How can I love my enemy as I love myself? And we recognize that we don't always do that. We're not always conscious of how our actions affect other people. And when we are aware of how our actions affect other people, sometimes we still choose to do things anyway, even if they're bad for others. So we need to repent. We need to turn. And instead of putting our hope in the powers that be around us, we need to put our hope in the God who's on the way, Jesus. So I invite you to join with me as we pray our prayer of repentance and turn to God. Let's read together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Let's ask God to make us people who are more hungry for peace than we are. We want peace internationally when it comes to wars, but more in our day-to-day lives, what we really need is for God to help us have peace interpersonally. Ask God to help you become someone who wants to encourage people instead of beating them. Ask God to help you become someone who wants to bless people. God's peace is not found in defeating our enemies or by winning. God's peace is rooted in the coming of a child. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. This coming child is the foundation of God's government, of God's kingdom. It says, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Shalom is one of the main ideas in the book of Isaiah. Shalom means peace, harmony, and wholeness. God wants shalom for the whole world, for people with God, for people with each other, and for people with everything else God has created. And God's shalom is built on the arrival of this child. His government and peace, shalom, will increase forever. I'm going to read the names of this child, and as I do, I want you to listen for which one of these names stands out to you today, and then reflect on that name for a few moments. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Shalom. Of the greatness of his government and shalom, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness, from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. In the book of Isaiah, God's shalom comes from justice and righteousness. I like to summarize it this way, that justice is when we have a right relationship with everything else God has made, with all the other people God's made, people we know and people we don't know. And righteousness is when we have a good relationship with God. And you can't have one without the other. It's like a corner that needs to be square. To have a right relationship with God, an upright relationship, means that your horizontal relationships are right as well. They're just. When we have righteousness and justice, that's where peace comes from. But none of us are righteous all the time. None of us are just all the time. But this child who's promised, he will be righteous and just, and that's why his peace will increase forever. His shalom will increase forever. This coming child will rule forever with righteousness and peace, and he will be the Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. We're going to receive communion now, so I invite you to take out your bread or crackers and wine or grape juice. When we celebrate communion, one of the names for it, the most common older name, is the Eucharist. Eucharist means thanksgiving. And we give thanks to God because although our world is not at peace, Jesus has initiated peace in our world. Although our world is not just, there is not justice in our world, Jesus brings justice. Although our world is not right, it's not righteous, Jesus brings righteousness. So we can be thankful that although things are not peaceful or just or righteous all the way, in Jesus, those things are breaking into the world. Light is breaking into the darkness. And we can experience that peace, justice, and righteousness for us, and then we can live in those ways of peace, justice, and righteousness as we go through our lives by ourselves and with others. And we don't always experience those things, but God is there every day with his peace, his justice, and his righteousness. So let's receive the Eucharist. Let's receive this thanksgiving as we give thanks to God for bringing us the child who is the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Let's partake of the bread and the cup. Jesus, we long for you to bring peace to the whole world, to bring justice to the whole world, to bring righteousness to the whole world. And we invite you to bring your peace, justice, and righteousness to us, to initiate those things in us. Rule in our hearts. May the increase of your government and peace know no ends, starting within us and then throughout the world. Let's sing together as we invite Jesus to rule in our hearts.
Born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee, Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth. Thou desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to kingdom bring by thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone by thine all-sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne. Desperate for you, Lord, we are waiting for you. Come, make us new, make all things new. Lord, we are longing for you, longing for you, desperate for you. Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee, Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth. Thou art dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart, joy of every longing heart.
The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you, as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle, and every garment rolled in blood, will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness, from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. May you be full of the love of the Father and the power of the Holy Spirit as you walk in the way of Jesus.